Amen, amen. So God is good. Yeah. We have been going through the 40 days of prayer for the last several weeks, and we're just about finished. And I pray that it's been a blessing to you. I know if you're in your small groups, it would be a tremendous blessing as you reinforce it. And of course, we've been having a wonderful time on Wednesday night, doing our family night and our prayer time. And God has been blessing. And so today, as we turn our attention once again to the 40 days of prayer, and this is week 6, we're going to be looking at the topic, how to pray for healing and restoration.
There you go.
How to pray for healing and restoration. You know, and when we look at the topic, we'll be talking about healing. It's not just physical healing, but also healing in your finances, healing in your families, healing in the country on a whole, because there could be sickness and a need of healing all around us. And so we ought to be praying for healing and restoration, right? Amen? If you have your Bible, turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And when you find it, say amen. And when you find you can stand so we can read God's word. And if you don't stand, you mean that you're telling me, so you can say wait. Wait, I ain't got it yet. But if you don't have your Bibles this morning, you can look at the screen and we have it there for you. And the Bible says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and I will heal their land. Let us pray. Our Father in God, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you for your word. We thank you, O God, for your faithfulness. And we pray now that you would teach us something new from your word, dear Lord, so that we can apply it to our lives and, oh God, we can live a Christian life that brings honor and glory to your name. Oh God, we all are seeking healing in some way or the other, dear Lord. Help us, oh God, to understand your word clearly so that we can, oh God, apply its truth so that we can receive the healing that we need. We praise your name today, dear Lord. We thank you for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you so much. You may be seated. The Bible says, if my people who are called by my name, if my people, who are these people? The Bible says in Matthew 12, 46 and 50 says, while Jesus was teaching the crowd, his mother and brothers waited nearby to speak to him. And someone told Jesus, your people wants to talk to you. Jesus said, just ask a question. He said, who is my family? Then pointing to his followers, he said, these people are my family. And anyone who obeys my Father in heaven and does his will is my brother and my sister and my mother. So the Bible said, if my people, Jesus said, those who have trusted in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior are the people of God. They're the ones. He said, if my people who are called by my name, see, God's people have authority. God's people have power. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. See, you can understand. In Mark 8 and 38 says this. Jesus said, if anyone is ashamed of me and my word in this unfaithful and immoral generation, I will be ashamed of him when I return in glory with all my angels. See, God's people ain't ashamed of him. Are you ashamed of God? Do you spend time talking to God? Do you know? Because you want a healing.
Yes.
And God's people got to be God's people. Do you really, really want a healing? Then you got to live and you got to obey and you got to follow the word of God. See, in order for you to get a healing, there's four conditions for healing and restoration. And we're going to look at those this morning. Because it brings healing in your body. It brings healing in your mind. It brings healing in your emotions. It brings healing in your relationships, and it brings healing in your finances. All aspects, it brings healing. There are four conditions of healing. Number one, you gotta admit this, and this is hard for a lot of us to do. Admit I'm not in control. Are you in control? Admit that you're not in control. The Bible says, if my people will humble themselves, right? Humbling yourself means you gotta admit in control. And what is that called? It's called humility. Saying, God is God and I am not. See, because when you act and when you walk and when you live as if you are in control, you are saying, God, you're not God. I am God. I am in charge and I can do what I want to do. Right? Somebody wants to sing a song saying, I did it my way. I did it my way. See, you did it your way, that's why you failed. You gotta do it God's way. Because only God's way is successful. You know? See, you gotta admit that you are not in control. Say, God is God and I am not. God is God and I am not. The first condition for healing and restoration in your life, if my people will humble themselves. Humility is the first step. So you don't approach God arrogantly. You're approaching God arrogantly, like you're in control. Proudly, flippantly, disrespectful. No, you got to know how to approach God. You got to understand that he is sovereign. Yes. He is holy. He is righteous. Mm-hmm. And we are so unworthy. And so when we approach God, we have to approach God the right way because he is sovereign. He is in control. See, one thing we got to know. The Bible never says to pray for humility. Huh? The Bible never says pray for humility. It just says humble yourself. That's not something that you got to do. People say, oh, Lord, humble me. The Bible never says, no, you got to humble yourself. Humility is a choice. It's a decision that you have to make. Humble yourself in the presence of God. And he will lift you up. Humility is important to God. He don't take it lightly. And if you come to God the wrong way, ain't nothing happening. You don't get your healing and your restoration because you're acting all the time like you are in control. How does God respond to the humble heart? How does God respond to the humble heart? It says, if I'm humble, God will guide me. If I'm humble, God will guide me. Psalms 25:9 says, God leads the humble in the right way and teaches them his will. So you could be going someplace. You could be going for us someplace, but you could be going in the wrong direction. The Bible says, God leads the humble in the right way and guides them. Guides them, you know, and teaches them his will. See, you got to follow God. I remember when we were away to the conference and Pastor Edgecombe, I was the driver and Pastor Edgecombe was the navigator. Right? And every place we had to go, Pastor Edgecombe said, all right, we get it. And all of a sudden, he used to connect. He said, get Wi-Fi, and he connect to a higher authority. Right? And when he put in the address that where we need to go, all he said, go right now, turn left. You know, he had me up and down, turning this way, turning that way. But he was following direction. You know, he said, 5 miles, you should see this, and you should see that, 2 miles, or what, you know, maybe you should be seeing it now. And then once we follow the direction that the high authority was giving us, we always arrive at the right location. We always arrive at the right destination. And with plenty of time, right? See, my friends, the Bible is telling us that it's not new. While Pastor Eddie was hooking into Google Map, right, to the internet, we get a greater authority for life who will guide us and lead us to life. But you got to humble yourself. Because if you don't humble yourself, you're going to face some tough days, some tough times, some situations going to come your way. Why? Because you didn't humble yourself. Because when you humble yourself and God's present, he leads you. And he guides you, saying, no, don't go that way. Turn left. No, he said, stop there. Don't go in that door. Come away, go up left. And he will show you where to go. The Holy Spirit will be working in your heart, and they will tell you where to go. If I'm humble, God bless me. He will bless you. You know what? Anybody want to get a blessing?
Yes.
You want to humble yourself. Yes. The Bible says in Isaiah 62:2, I will bless those who are humble and contrite hearts. You wonder why you aren't getting blessed. You know, because you're not humble. You're too arrogant. You don't puff up. And God can't work with that. He said, humble yourself. if I humble myself, God will bless me. And number three, if I humble myself, God will give me the power to change. Man, you don't got no power on your own. Don't care how much you try to stop doing that thing. No matter how much you try to overcome that situation, you can't because you don't got the power. You rely on your strength. You know, people always say, man, look, I got this. I know I can handle this. I got this, right? I can deal with that. Take it, you can handle it. Say, I can stop smoking marijuana anytime I want. Huh? Did that happen to you? Do raise your hand. Do raise your hand. Right? I can stop talking to that person anytime I want. I can stop anytime I want. No! You can't change it like that. God's power alone can help you to change and transform your situation. Only God can do it. James 4 and 6 says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Yeah. God is able to help you overcome the situations and the challenges that you're facing. Yeah. Only God can do it. If you're humble, see, that's why humility, being humble, is so important. For if I'm humble, number four, God will relieve your stress. Anybody got stressed this morning? See, there's good stress and there's bad stress. We're talking about the bad stress. Anybody got bad stress this morning?
Yes.
See, if you're humble, God will get rid of that. He will deal with that. The Bible says in Matthew 11 and 29, Jesus speaking, he said, take the yoke I give you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble, and I will restore deep rest you to your soul. See, God wants you to have rest in your soul. Having peace in your soul. You're up all night, stressed out, worried, confused, don't know what to do. Go to sleep, man. Why are you up all night? You have deep rest in your soul. And you're stressed out. In the middle of the storm on the lake, Jesus was sleeping. He said, I got no stress. That was a good sleep. I believe Jesus, that waves was rocking that boat. You know what I mean? You can rock the child to sleep. That waves was rocking that boat. Jesus, that was sleeping. No stress. No stress at all. See, because Jesus, in his sovereignty, in his power, and in his glory, humbled himself to the will of Almighty God, of God the Father, and came to earth as a man. And Jesus said, you know, stress. God already take care of all this. And he was just in the boat, resting, relaxing. And then when he get up, he just said, man, what y'all worrying about? I hear. What you stress out about?
That's right.
You know? If Jesus is the center of the Lord of your house, and he's governing over your house, what you worrying about? If Jesus is your authority, he's in your heart. He lives within me today. What you worrying about? You go in the office like you're scared, you're timid, you're stressed out all day. You don't want nobody to talk to you. Say, good morning. Why are you stressed out? God got it. Turn it over to Jesus.
Yes.
He said, take my yoke. You give me that burden. Take my yoke. Let me deal with that. You can understand. If you humble yourself, you can rest. You can go home and rest. Say, well, you know, your spouse may be saying, what about this and what about that? I go to sleep. I get rest. Right? Because you know God got it under control and he will provide. You know what he's going to do, but you know he can do something.
Yes.
You know, I put it to God and say, God, I'm your child. I know you're sovereign. I come to you in the Jesus' name. And your word says, if I ask anything, you got to talk to God.
Yeah.
And what God do great things in your heart and your life, he's able to do it, but you got to believe.
Yeah.
And you got to trust in him. So the first thing we know is you got to humble yourself. That's important. That's important. I hope today, if you learn anything today, you learn that, to be humble. Mm-hmm. And let the power of God get turned on in your life. And then the second thing is this. Ask God for help. You got to ask the right person for help. You don't call the police for what the doctor to pull you to, right? You got to call the right person. You don't call the heart surgeon to pull your teeth, because, right? You got to call the right person, right? Ask God for help. He said, if my people will pray. That's the second thing. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and what? Pray. You got to understand. You aren't waiting on God. God is waiting on you to pray. For many, praying for healing is scary. But you got to pray. You got to open and trust and believe in God. You don't think the centurion was afraid. He was scared, but he still gone to Jesus and asked. He prayed. He gone to Jesus. The woman with the issue of blood, she was afraid, but she gone to Jesus because she needed a healing. Jairus, he gone to Jesus because his daughter was sick. He gone to the one who can make a difference. See, a lot of times we go to the wrong people to try. You talk to your friend. Why are you talking to them? They can't help you. You talk to your relative. They can't help you. Talk to Jesus. He is the one who can help you. John 16 and 23 says this. Jesus speaking. I tell you the truth. My Father will give you anything you ask in my name. You see that? You are his child. Until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. But this is a new dimension. This is a new dispensation. This is a new revelation of grace. He said, until now, you have not asked for anything in my name. Ask, and you will receive so that your joy will be the fullest joy possible. Man, Jesus wants to fill you right up. Jesus wants to bless you. Jesus wants to touch you. Jesus wants to anoint you. But you got to ask.
Yes.
He said, come on, man. I'm making all these things. And the thing about it is, Jesus is at the right hand of the Father.
Yeah.
And at the right hand of the Father, you ask in Jesus' name. And right there. Father, you hear him? That's my child. You hear what he say? Right there. Like close proximity right there.
That's right.
In Jesus' name. So you got the two covers right there. And you're praying to the power of the Spirit. You get covering. You humble yourself and you come in God's presence. Prostrate on the ground and say, Lord, I need your help. Help me. I'm your child. Who here today? Who have a child? When they come in humility and sincerity prostrate and say, Mommy, Daddy, I need your help. Man, you'll get up in your bed the latest hour in the night and you'll run to help them no matter where they are. Because you love them. Because you care about them. No matter what situation, you will fly to Jabim. You're scared of flying, but you will fly to wherever they are. And you will be there saying, honey, I'll be there as quick as possible. You will go and break the bank, and you will get on that plane. Why? Because you care about them.
Yeah.
They my daughter need help. My son need help. And you don't think your heavenly Father in heaven, even, oh man, in Jesus' name, I'm crying out to you. I'm pleading. I said, Lord, help me. Yeah. I need your help. I need your touch. I need your healing. I need your anointing.
Yeah. Yes.
And Jesus, anything, ask. That he can help you because he wants your joy. Then your joy would be to the fullest. He wants to fill you up. He wants you to be smiling when you're walking. And he wants you to have a glow on your face. How y'all doing? Oh, my God is good. How y'all doing? Oh, I praise the Lord. How you doing? I'm walking in the anointing. How you doing? The Holy Spirit is all around. See you. He wants you to be full up. So that everything you're speaking about the goodness of God in your heart and your life. You gotta understand what he's saying to you. You know, you gotta remember Jesus wants you to ask. He wants you to ask. He wants you to say, call out and cry out.
Yes.
He wants you to ask for things, right? He may not give you everything you want, but he's gonna ask. He wants you to ask for it. He's gonna bless you. I don't give my daughter everything she wants because sometimes she asks for things. I say, well, no, that's enough. Right? But I bless her.
Yes.
And so that she come back and back and back. Because why? Because she know that daddy's gonna bless me. Daddy got my back. Yeah. Daddy, all she do is say, Daddy, it's $3. That's all she say, $3. $3. And she don't know where the $3 coming from, but Daddy, it's $3. And she'll tell me on Tuesday, Daddy, Friday coming, and they have dress up there at $3. Now she in faith believing that. Why don't you tell Daddy? It's over. The money down. So all she doing, she going, the mommy, dress up there. I need something to wear. So she's straight with the dress and say, Daddy, $3. And And they serve him with chicken and fries for like $4. Right? And faith, believe it. Yeah. Like a childlike faith, you gotta believe that God will do it for you.
Yes.
He's able.
Hallelujah.
You gotta understand. That's faith.
Yes.
And then you gotta ask in Jesus' name. You gotta ask in his name. But God wants you to ask and believe, and he will do great things in your heart and your life.
Yeah.
You want to see healing and restoration? You got to have like a childlike faith. Believe it in God.
That's right.
And he will do it for you.
That's right.
He will do it for you. James 5, 13 and 15 says this. Is anyone of you in trouble? He should pray. Is anyone happy? Let him sing praises. Why are you singing praises? You're telling me happy. I often ask people how things going. They say, oh, everything all right. Oh, I got everything is great. But why are you in prison? You should be singing with joy. Is there anybody, that's what the Bible says. Is any one of you sick? He or she should call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise him up. If he has sinned, he will be forgiven. You see that? God said, you're going to call the elders. Don't let the elders just show up of their own. Call them. Because your faith is the key. Because you got to believe. Your faith is the key. And so you said, Lord, your word said, if I call the elders and ask them to pray and anoint me, I'll be healed. Believe in God. And that's it. Because Lord, Friday coming. So you gotta believe. Like a faith. You don't know what happened, but you know on Friday, everything will be alright.
Yes.
I will have a wonderful and a joyful time because everything is just alright. And I'll have everything I need. God is there waiting for you to call. He's waiting for you to ask. He's waiting for you to humble yourself.
Yes.
Get over other people. Sorry. Get other people to pray with you. See, a lot of times you like to pray by yourself. But sometimes you need to get other people to pray and agree with you. Amen? You need to get other people to pray and agree with you. Right? You know, you got to get other people. That's number three. Get other people to pray with you. Remember, right? Remember, you need to get other people to pray with you. Right? You know, because it's important. Because sometimes when you're sick, you're in a condition where you can't even think straight. Right? You taking a medication they just give you. Right? Some of the medication they give you, right? They give you some medication that, you know, they make you sleepy, they make you groggy. I say, hey, you gonna take one painkiller one day for lunchtime. Man, I couldn't do nothing else for the rest of the day. Right? I was sleepy. I ain't never taking that again. Never, right? Right? Remember that God wants you. See, get other people to pray with you. That's important. Get other people to pray with you. Then Matthew 18 and 19 says this. Jesus speaking. He said, I tell you the truth, that if just two of you on earth agree together about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. You gotta need somebody to agree with you. Now, you need somebody who's praying with you and believing like you, because you can't just pray with anybody. Somebody who believes and agrees with you, right? And you all agree together. He said, Jesus said, I tell you that if just two of you on earth agree together about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. You got to agree. Believe it in faith. Right? So you gotta have the right set of people around you praying with you and praying for you. And every situation, because a lot of times you're in the middle of things and you need help as you go through it. So that's so important. And then, believe and expect an answer. Believe and expect an answer. Number four, believe and expect an answer. I think the PowerPoint news track. So you got the next one is believe and expect an answer. Right? Believe. You gotta believe and expect that. You can't just pray and don't believe what you're praying for. Right? You pray and you don't believe what you're praying for. You gotta believe and expect an answer.
That's right.
And then, you know, because you can't, you pray and pray to the Lord, I believe,
yeah,
and you expect God to answer. And then number five, keep on praying until God tells you to stop. Keep on praying until God tells you to stop, right? Keep on praying until God tells you to stop. Ephesians 6 and 18 says this, pray in the Spirit at all times, with all kinds of prayers, asking for all you need. To do this, you must always be ready and never give up. Always pray for all God's people. Always pray for all God's people, right? I always pray for all God's people. And that's so important. Pray, pray, pray until God gives an answer. All right? And now, the third condition in order for you to have answered prayer is this. Seek God, not a miracle. The third condition is this. Seek God and not a miracle. Seek God and not a miracle. If my people, the Bible says in 2 Chronicles 7 and 14, he said, if my people will seek my face. See, what you seeking? Who you seeking? You seeking somebody else, but you're not seeking God. He said, if my people will seek my face. He said, seek him, not merely his blessings. See, a lot of times we want the blessing, but we don't want to seek God. Many people want to come to God and get a blessing. They want to come to church on Sunday to get a blessing, but they don't want to spend time with God. They don't want to get to know God. They don't want to experience God. See, God is just like us, right? God is just like us. We want to have a relationship with you. We want to have the commitment. Proverbs 8 and 7 says, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. See, I love those who love me, and those who seek me find me. Find me. See, God said, I want you to seek me. And if you seek me, you will find me. Because God said, you're serious. See, a lot of times you come to God, you come the wrong way. God said, you're not serious. You're not serious at all. You're seeking God, but you're not seeking him in the right way. Because when you seek him, you're looking for a miracle. People come who ain't had no relationship with God, expecting a great miracle to happen in their life, and yet they don't want to know Jesus. See, in every situation, Jesus challenged the faith of every person who came to him for anything. Because you believe, Jesus said, the relationship. You believe in me. You believe in me. And because of that, so let it be done. Let it be done in your heart, your life. See, you want a miracle, but you don't want a relationship. And that ought not to be like that. You want the blessing. You want the big bank account. And yet you don't want to have a relationship with God. Now, a lot of people tell me all the time, man, I wish I could get all this money, right? And I said to myself, if you get all that money, people never, never, never see you again. Never see you again, right? See, because not everybody can handle all that blessing.
Yeah.
Not everybody can handle it. That's why God said, you want a miracle to happen, but I want a relationship. He said, I love those who love me, and those who seek me will find me. Right? And then Hebrews 11, 6 says, God rewards those who earnestly seek him. God rewards those who earnestly. You want a reward? Seek God. You want a blessing? Seek God. You want an anointing? Seek God. You want a special touch? Seek God, because God will reward you. See, my friends, there's blessings close to God. There's special anointing close to God. There's a special covering when you're close to God. But when you're far away, outside, and you're not getting the blessing that God wants to bless you with. See, it's so important. And then Psalms 14 and 2 tells us, the Lord looks down from heaven on the entire human race. He looks to see if there is even one with real understanding, one who seeks after God. See, God wants you and I to seek him, to trust him, to rely upon him, to serve him. Seek God. The miracle's going to come, you know. The miracle that you're seeking for is going to come. God has done many miracles in our lives. that, but he said, just seek me. Don't just seek the miracle. Don't just seek the, seek me. You want God to heal you, and then you don't want to have nothing to do with God. You come to church on Sunday, and that's the last time God see you all be. Every day of the week, you're doing all kinds of nonsense. Then you come back on Sunday, say, you say you're seeking God. No! God said, ain't nothing happening like that. You got to seek God all week, every day. The Bible says, if you seek the Lord, your God, you will find him. If you look for him with all your heart and with all your soul, when you are in distress and all these things have happened to you, you will return to the Lord your God and obey him. For he is merciful, for he is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you. See, God wants to bless you. He wants to pour all his blessings upon you. But he says, spend time with me. Study my word. Read about me. Talk to me. Let me hear from you on a daily basis. I want to know you better too. He says, seek me. That's what God is saying. I want to increase you. I want to expand your territory. But I want you to seek me. And that's so important that we do that. God goes overboard for those who put their trust and put their faith in him. Seek first, the Bible says, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be given unto you. See, that's what the Bible said. Your priority in your life have to be right in order for you to get the blessing that you expect from God. Every day of your life. The Christian life is not just one day of the week. The Christian life is to be lived every day of the week. Every day should be a day of thanksgiving with the Lord. Every day should be a day of praise with the Lord. Every day should be a day of rejoicing. Every day a day of submission to the Lord. Every day we ought to be humbling ourselves before the Lord. Every day we should be experiencing the blessings of the Lord. Every day we should be walking in the Spirit. Every day. So the power of God will move greatly within us. If we're living with him and walking with him and talking with him every day of our lives, not just only on Sunday. And then the last point we have is this, number four. It said, turn my attention from the world to the word. Turn my attention from the world to the word. Turn my attention from the world to the word. What's your attention? What's keeping your attention? A lot of times in life, instead of us looking to Jesus, we're looking at the world. Instead of us looking to Jesus, we're looking at our circumstances. Instead of us looking to Jesus, we're looking at our bank account. Instead of us looking at to Jesus, we're looking at our shortcomings. My friends, if you continue to look at yourself, you're going to be discouraged. You're going to be depressed. You're going to be down all the time. The Bible says, don't look at the world. Look to Jesus. He said, turn from their wicked ways. Turn from the world. Turn from the wicked ways. See, the wickedness. There's wickedness in the world. And the wickedness in the world will pull you down. But the Bible tells us, turn from the wicked ways. Turn from the world. See, because what is wickedness? Wickedness is forgetting God. Wickedness is forgetting God. That's what it is. See, because it's wicked to come and worship God on Sunday and then forget God on Monday. Forget God on Tuesday. Forget God until 6 o'clock on Wednesday. And then at 8:30, you forget God until Sunday comes. No, that ought not to be. And the world is like that. They don't pay no attention. Listen to the world. The world want to put he, she, and you know, that's so confusing. You got the man, the male bathroom, the female bathroom, now they want to have it. He, she, bathroom. I don't understand how it works. And then the wickedness in the world, they don't want to have nothing to do with God.
That's right.
You know, they don't want to have God in the heart. You know, and they come with marital rape. And the Bible tells us that when you're married, you become one flesh. And if you're married and you're one flesh, how could one flesh rape itself? I'm trying to figure it out yet. You know, they're trying to attack God by because the world is looking away from God. They don't want to have nothing to do with God, and so they'll come up with these things that will attack what God has already set up. See, they're confused. Then they come up with these things, but the child don't know what they are. Right? A long time ago, they told me, say, either you are flat or you're no, right? 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 So they say two flats will make a no. Right? You cannot go against God. See, there's a world of wickedness. And we'll go right there behind them. But you know, that makes sense. See, if I don't line up with the word of God, it didn't make no sense to me. It don't make no sense. It got to line up with God's word. What does God's word say about it? And that's why it's important that we know what God's word say about these things. See, when Apostle Paul talked about homosexuality and all these things in the Bible, they said, well, Apostle Paul was a mean, he was this. They want to talk bad about him. Why? Because the world want to run away from Jesus. Right. See, you want something to happen in your life, you got to stay and you got to know what God's word says. Look to the word. Don't look to the world. Because the world is full of wickedness and the world ain't going to get no better.
That's right.
It ain't getting no better. It's going to get worse and worse. You think it bad now. You watch. I was talking to one of the brothers just this week and we were talking about all this. One of my IT friends. I was talking to him and I said, man, look here, this technology is getting so serious. You know? Because right now, you're getting all these different numbers. Sister Optimus, them give you a national insurance card, and they say the national insurance card get a chip in it. Then the new card they got a chip in their card, a credit card, they got a chip in that. And the chip got all your information, right? And then they're getting all these things where they forcing you. The bank say, you gotta go online. You cannot come to the bank to do certain transactions. I said, you know something? They're getting ready for the Antichrist. They're pushing you. So you got to get online, and you got to get this. And then when they put you online, they give you this long number. So you got to key in, and then you got to put in your bank account after that. So they got you, and then you, everything, go online. So they know exactly everything you're doing. I cannot go to the bank anymore and deposit anything on Sister Sherry's account. I cannot do that. Even though I didn't think it yet, whatever I was thinking about it, I can't do it no more. The world is getting wicked. And if you look into the world, the things, you gotta be careful. So that you understand this. When they take these computers and they make you sign in. When you get the phones, they make you sign in. So you get an Android system and you gotta sign up a Google account. What you think? They got Google Analytics. And it will track everything you do on the computer every day. Everything you do is recorded. And they know, how do you think they know? They send you those ads. They say, oh, they say, you will buy one. I think you will be every, you know, I went in to buy some vitamins and whatnot. And what happened? When I bought the vitamins, the next thing I know, every website, would you believe, Brother Greg, every website I go, advertising the vitamins. And how they know? Every website I go out, they have it on the web, the vitamins pop up on the side. Pop up. I said, what in the world? They remind me, say, oh. And then I said, man, this is... But then, see, they are tracking everything. So, no matter. When you go to, if you move from the Bahamas, you go to the States, they know you. They track you. The telephone that you have, they know exactly where all of us are right here in this building. They can see that. You can turn that phone off, take out the battery and take out everything, and they still know where you are. They can track you. So the Antichrist can find you because we like to talk. We like to use the phone. They can find you, right? So you gotta be strong and you gotta know the word of God, my friends, because this world is moving towards wickedness and corruption and evilness, and you wonder why. You just watch television. I said, how in the world could the Antichrist get all these people to take? But I watch the news, and I see how the media just brainwash people to believe something, and they slowly just simple word it over and over and over again. And they, all they can say, you may not be a thief, Sister Sherry, but all the media does is say, Sister Sherry is a thief. Sister Sherry is a thief. And they say, you say it often enough, you start to believe it. That's what they do, and they do it every day. And that's why you got to be careful as you assess what any media source, especially the United States one, say to you. That's so important. because they push things your way because they want to make sure you believe things. They're trying to shape your mind and your worldview and everything. So you got to be careful about that. And that's so important. That's why the Bible tells us that we've got to look to the Word of God, not to the world. Because the world is going to pull you down. He said, and that's so important. It says this. You have forgotten the God who saved you. And you have not remembered the God, that God is your place of safety. See, you've forgotten God because you're so full of the world. You're full of the world in because the world could keep you busy. The world could get you busy until when you get home in the night to the door, they can't bring no more tired. Keep you busy all day. The word gone out of your soul. And that's why it's so important that you turn. Turn means you got to, turn in that passage means you got to turn or return or repent. That's what it basically means. Repent and return to me. That's what God is saying. And Isaiah, that's so important. In Acts 3 and 19, it tells us this. Repent and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, so that the times of refreshing may come from the Lord. See, you got to turn to God. See, God wants you to get caught up in the rapture. He don't want you to leave here. Because if you got to leave behind, there could be some tough things going on. For what? And you don't want to be in that. And some of us like Kentucky. Some of us like to eat big and all this stuff. And you want to eat big in them days, you got to get the mark. You got to get the mark to eat the food because the chip for the hand is coming. The chip might be in a card today, but they have the chip. Are they already testing out? I see them on video testing out the one for the hand. They put under the fist so that instead of you waving, you just bear the thing. See, when you're traveling now, they make me put my hand there and all these things. And they get you. I can't hide no more. They put my hand there. Yeah. I put my hand on the thing. Yeah. And they got my hand. Oh, Lord, they got me in this thing now. That's the only thing you can travel. You can't travel no more. Yeah. They get sophisticated. They got you in the computer. They got you going. They don't go to the prison first. You go to the computer. And you got to stand there and take the picture. Yeah. And they say, that's a good picture. I said, well, you say that, but look good to me. And they put your hand down. They got you in the system. So anywhere you go, they can track you. They make it to the hospital and put everything on the computer. They're linking it up. You talking about the e-passport? What do you need an e-passport for? Everywhere they can get you. The e-passport got a chip in it. They're everywhere you go, they can everything. All your birth certificate, all the information, when they put it on the thing, all that come up for them, in the front of them. All there. So you are in the system. Like somebody say, you're in the matrix. So you got to watch that. And so you got to turn to God. Turn to God. See, God promises us some things, man. And because God is good. And that's why we got to trust in him. Because he cares for his children. God said, if you want healing in your life, if you want restoration, you gotta repent. He says in Proverbs 28 and 13, it says this, if you hide your sins, you will not succeed. But if you confess and reject them, you will receive mercy. God is a merciful God. And then James 5 and 16 says this, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Because confess your sin. Your sin can be preventing your healing. God says, confess your sin. And he promises us these three things. He promises us these three things. You can write them in. I will hear from heaven. That's what God promised. That's his promise. That he will hear from heaven. Next slide. He said, I will hear from heaven. I will forgive your sins. And I will heal your life. That's what God promises. See, a lot of times we have a sick government, we got a sick system, things seem corrupt in our nation, things seem not to be going right. Why? Because our land needs healing. The people in our land need healing. God said, I will hear from heaven, number one. I will forgive your sin, and I will heal your land. That's what God wants to do for us today. He wants to do that for you and I, but Many of us do want to humble ourselves, do want to turn from our wicked ways. We do want to pray. And because of that, we lose out on the blessings of God. God want to bless you. He want to bless you in a special way today. He already blessed us this morning with the rain. And he want to bless us even more. He want to bless us today, and he want us to be healed from whatever infirmities that we are facing today. So as we bow this morning, and I don't know what you're going through, but God is saying to you and I today, it's time to get healed. It's time to be blessed. It's time for your anointing to become evident in your life. All you have to do is believe in me. Exercise your faith in me today and watch me do great and mighty things in your heart and your life. Do you believe God can heal you this morning?
Yes.
Do you believe God can restore you this morning?
Yes.
Do you believe God can do a great work in your life this morning?
Yes.
If you believe that, just raise your hand.
Yes.
Do you want God to heal you today?
Yes.
Do you want God to move in your heart in a mighty way today? Do you want it today? Let me see your hand if you want God to heal you today. And if you want God to heal you today, you gotta let go this morning. Let go of what you're holding on. Seek God's forgiveness today. Seek him. Believe in him this morning. And watch him do a great work in your heart today. Because I want to agree with you for healing this morning. The Bible said if two of us agree, we will ask God, and if two of us, my Heavenly Father will do it. Let us agree this morning. Let us believe in faith. And ask God today for a healing, for a touch for you today. And watch God do a great work in your heart and your life. Because God can do it. God can do it. God can do it. He can do it just for you. Our Father in God, in Jesus' name, I come to you this morning.
In Jesus' name.
Agree with my brothers and sisters, your people, your children who are standing around the altar today, dear Lord. Oh God, we praise your name this morning. Oh God, hear their cry today. They have come today asking and seeking you for a healing, seeking a special touch from you today, dear Lord.
Yeah.
Oh God, they come today seeking a transformation, seeking, oh God, that you would move in their hearts and their lives in a mighty way, dear Lord. Oh God, I come today as your servant, believing with them.
Yeah.
Oh God, believing for a miracle in their hearts and their lives in a great and awesome way today, dear Lord. Oh God, may your spirit, oh God, move upon them even now.
Yeah.
May you touch them, oh God, from the crown of their head to the sole of their feet, dear Lord. May you, oh God, meet them today at their point of need, dear Lord. And may you heal them in the name of Jesus Christ, dear Lord. Oh Father God, I pray to you today, asking that you would, oh God, touch your children today. We cry out to you, dear Lord. Believe in, dear Lord. Believe in like the centurion. Believe in like the woman with the issue of blood. Believe in, oh God, that you are able to do in the Lord, dear Lord. We believe in you, dear Lord, asking you for healing, dear Lord. Your word says, seek and you shall find.
Yes.
Knock and it shall be opened.
Yes,
ask and it shall be given. In Jesus' name, I come to you today, dear Lord, on behalf of my brothers and sisters, asking that you would touch them, asking that you would heal them, asking, oh God, that you would meet their need, whatever it may be today, dear Lord. Because, oh God, we believe in you today, dear. We trust in you, dear Lord, and because of that, we come to you, believing in your word, believing that you will do it, dear Lord. Oh God, I commit their prayers to you today, dear Lord. I commit their requests to you today, dear Lord. I agree with them today, dear Lord. Have your way. Have your way. Have your way, dear Lord. May they yield to you, dear Lord. Oh God, if there be any sin in between you and us, dear Lord, I ask in Jesus' name that you forgive our sins. I ask, oh God, that you would cleanse us, oh God. By your Bible tells us, if we confess our sins, thou art faithful and just to forgive us our sins. I cleanse us from all unrighteousness, dear Lord. We come to you in Jesus' name, asking because we don't want nothing to hinder our blessing from you today, dear Lord, because we come seeking a blessing. We come seeking a touch. We come seeking an anointing. We come seeking your strength, dear Lord. We come seeking a move of your spirit in our hearts and our lives, dear Lord. Touch your people. Touch your people in Jesus' name. Yes. Oh, God, I pray. I praise your name. I thank you, oh, Heavenly Father, for answering prayers. I thank you for your blessings, dear Lord. I praise and I worship you, dear Lord. Hallelujah to your name. All glory and honor and praise be unto you today, dear Lord. For thou art worthy of all praise, all honor and all glory, oh God, because thou art faithful. Thou art worthy, dear Lord. Your grace is abounding, dear Lord. Your love is, oh God, never ending,
dear
Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh God, and we praise and we worship you today.
Thank you, thank you.
And we thank you, oh God.
Yes.
And we praise you today.
Thank you, Lord.
And we pray in our hearts and our lives. And we give you the honor. We give you the glory and we give you the praise. We commit these prayers in your hands. Yes. In Jesus Christ's name.
You move the power.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
You move mountains. You move mountains. You move mountains.